Hurricane wind blow, bust down the front door, broke all the windows, where'd all the trees go? Lake Pontchartrain rising like a house of the sun, and I bet you never thought Canal Street would be one.
That male lesbian guy,
All the girls to buy princesses, and all the boys thrice to buy superheroes.
Well, why?
Because girls want superheroes, and the boys want superheroes, and the girls want pink stuff, and the girls, and the boys want, and the boys don't want pink stuff. Yeah.
Boys want both, but why do you think they do that?
Because the companies who make these try to trick the girls into buying the pink stuff instead of stuff that boys want to buy, right?
Right, but you can buy either, right? And boys can buy either. If boys want to buy pink, they can buy pink, right?
Yeah, so then why do all the girls have to buy princesses? Some girls like superheroes, some girls like princesses. Some boy like superheroes, some boy like princesses.
Absolutely, so absolutely.
Why does all the girls have to buy pink stuff and all the boys have to buy different color stuff?
It's a good question, Riley.
Hello. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Larry, a male lesbian, and I'm just some dude. By male lesbian, I don't mean that I'm a gay woman trapped in a man's body. Although I guess that would be one way to look at it. It's not like I go around wearing a dress, although there was that one time. But no, it's really not about that. Really what it's about is the fact that human nature is so incredibly malleable, and science has shown us, human sexuality science in particular, has shown us over the last half century, basically, since the taboo has been lifted, since the 1960s, that our ideas of traditional gender roles and what gender actually is, the actual definition of it in the first place, is not correct, or at least not scientifically correct. So basically, our ideas of culture, our ideas of gender, these are largely manufactured by our current zeitgeist, wherever we happen to be in history at the time. And right now we're in a transition between two major points in history. And the gender roles that are the remnants of the gender roles that are still left over from the agrarian background that we came from with a particular division of labor is no longer relevant. So I'm an advocate for gender convergence, and I don't subscribe to the traditional notions in the current zeitgeist of masculinity and femininity. There was a metrosexual movement at one point, I guess would be pretty close to what I'm describing. So that's why I use the screen name Male Lesbian most places I go, and that's why I have a website called malelesbian.org, which I got the domain for that back in the 1990s when I was taking women's studies in college, and I've just kept it ever since. And it's provocative, it's easy to remember. When you say it, you know, like, if you ever been to some kind of like tabling event, like at an art market or something, and you tell somebody your website, and you're like, yeah, go to blogspot./. You know, and they're, yeah, right, whatever, you know. Or they would have to like give them a card or something because they'd have to write all down. But when you, and it doesn't quite register, you know, okay, you have some website. All right, I'll file that away for later. But when you tell somebody, yeah, my website is malelesbian.org, all one word, they're like, it's what? Like, what does that mean? You know what I mean? And then instantly you've created a memory. And that memory hopefully will drive web traffic to my website. And from there, it's basically just a portal for Zeitgeist. There's really no more information on there about what male lesbianism is, other than what I've just told you. But yeah, I mean, I've never been into sports, never been into competition, always been a big fan of socialism, and I'm from the left, although, as you'll see in later episodes, I've come into some conflict with one of my favorite lefties, and really, I mean, Zeitgeist is you know, from the very beginning has been a global movement that's been akin to the 99%, because 99% of us, practically 100% of us, right? Probably 100% of us need food, air, you know, clean air, good food, clean water, habitat to live in. We all have a certain common life ground. And it doesn't really matter what your ideology is or your religion is or any of that kind of stuff. And so, you know, liberalism serves its purpose in the current zeitgeist, but in order to change the zeitgeist, I kind of got to give that up. But one thing that I do like about zeitgeist is basically, you know, the scientific theorem with the idea of using the best of known processes from throughout time. Hell yeah, keep supply and demand. We don't need money to track supply and demand. Just do it as a technical process. You know, the humans demand these goods, and so the computers and robots supply those demands, you know, and just-in-time delivery, just like Walmart does today. So, you know, it's a system that's beyond all the creations and cultural creations of our recent zeitgeist. And but gender is just one of those dividing lines that is used to divide and conquer us by setting up, okay, a man has to be this way and a woman has to be this way. What you do is you set up this dichotomy where the readers of Playboy and the readers of Cosmos are perfect matches for each other because they've each been programmed to be so. So the readers of Playboy, you know, they have a certain aesthetic requirement for women and have a certain perception of them. And, you know, and there are some, you know, deep articles about gender and stuff in Playboy, so I'm not totally knocking it. And then on the other hand, you've got Cosmos and, you know, how to please your man 100 ways and wear this type of makeup and, you know, you'll get what you want. So yeah, it's... And these paths are set out in such a way that they do come into conflict. The different, you know, the idea that Freud had of, you know, you wrote a whole book, you know, what do women want? And, you know, penis envy and stuff like that. And, of course, you know, from a woman's point of view, that's not exactly correct. So... So yeah, I mean, it just puts us at odds with each other. It's just one more cleavage point for division among the 99%. And so that's why I bring it to the forefront. And, you know, if somebody, and it's also good because it's a good filter for me. Because if somebody is easily offended by a provocative term, then I don't really need to talk to them. You know what I mean? So if they're going to hear male lesbian and be like, oh, that's something bad, and run off, well, do they really have the open mind to receive the information that I want to give them anyway? So it's a good filter for me. I notice that when I say that and when it doesn't run somebody off, you know, I've got someone who's basically saying, tell me more, you know. But somebody puts up the hand and, you know, hey, I'm doing a video survey today, and I'd like to ask you a couple questions. Oh, no. You don't need to talk to those people. At least not yet. They'll come to the table when the time is right. But anyway, that's an explanation of malelesbian.org, and this is a pretty long monologue, I have to say. However, I do have a lot to cover in this video, and this will probably be this first pilot episode of NOLAz TV will probably be the longest, I think. I'm going to try to keep it to around an hour to an hour and a half. But in this episode, which I'm calling my New Year's episode, which I consider to be just, you know, an arbitrary marker of time. I chose this moment to, as a deadline for myself, on the one hand, to launch this show as a retrospective on the activism that we in the NOLAz zeitgeist community, the zeitgeist New Orleans community, have done over the past year and a half. Now, as far as I know, to the best of my knowledge, I am the first zeitgeist member in the New Orleans area. And I consider myself coordinator for Zeitgeist of New Orleans. Not that, you know, it was an elected position, I'm just self-appointed position because nobody else was doing anything, and, you know, there was no Facebook page for it yet, and so, you know, Peter Joseph says, look, do it. You know, it's like these people call into his radio program and say, you know, well, I want to do a lecture, and I want to do this, and his answer always is, do it. If you feel like you got the skills to do it, if you feel like you've got the gumption to do it, if you've got the resources to do it, then do it. So I did, and so here I am. And this is NOLAz TV.
Larry the Male Lesbian here with you, getting ready to do the Zeitgeist Orientation presentation. Got my computer set up, got my microphone, and there's the projection where it's gonna, where they're gonna see it, and the audience is gonna be right over there. This is about an hour before the show, so we're just waiting for people to arrive.
So, six people showed up, which was less than I had hoped for. You know, I advertised online on Craigslist and Facebook, and I told all my friends and coworkers, and you know, passed out flyers and all that good stuff. I got my name on the itinerary for the month for Zeitgeist Multidisciplinary Arts Center, which has the same name, but they actually, they've been around since 85, so they predate the movement. And I just thought, you know, just it seemed like all the planets had aligned, and this should freaking just happen, you know. But I had six people show up, and one of them stayed after the show to tell me his name was Ian, and that he had actually listened to my podcast from the beginning. So he had listened to all, 12 episodes that it was by that time. And said that it was because of the podcast that he had come to the Zeitgeist Multidisciplinary Arts Center to actually see the orientation guide. So it was a success, although not as big of a success as I had hoped for, obviously, but it was definitely a success. But I felt that there was something I was missing, something I was lacking, so when I heard that Jacques Fresco was going to be in Vancouver, I thought, well, this is the golden opportunity to go up there. You know, in Vancouver, I had some vacation time coming up, and I've always wanted to go to Vancouver. In fact, I've always wanted to live in Vancouver. And they have one of, if not the largest, most successful, most active, most organized chapters, at least in North America. So I figured, hell, if anybody knows how to do it, surely they will.
So I got a golden ticket, and I got the vacation time, and then Jacques Fresco canceled, and that was a big bummer. But then I met this guy, Matt Berkowitz.
Hello, live from Vancouver. It is NOLAz Radio, New Orleans Zeitgeist Radio, but this week live from Vancouver. This is the 14th episode, and I have the privilege of visiting one of the most modern cities I've ever been to. It's probably the closest that I've ever seen to Venus Project existence, although still pretty far away. And It's as modern as it is surrounded by ancient beauty. It's got the sea on one side, virgin mountain wilderness on the other. But I'm really impressed with the transportation system here, the way it's all really well integrated and integrated with the internet to where I can use my cell phone to get me around. Each of the stations has their own little stops for the buses that they call bays, and it just tells you exactly which bay to go to and where that takes you to. One thing I think everyone, I don't see why I don't do this in every city, but each of the bus stops actually has a little 5-digit code that you can call a phone number and type in that code. It'll tell you when the bus is coming and where it's going to and everything else. So really impressed with the modern system. It's a very big city, but very clean, modern, almost clinical. I tell you, one of the first things that I noticed when I got off of the SkyTrain, it was kind of like going into Willy Wonka's factory, and I see these, they have all those crazy machines and processes going on. And I see these electric buses that are going in two different directions at the same time on the same street. And it just seems like they were all over the place, like it was bustling with electric buses. But anyway, that was my very first impression of the city. Thanks to Matt, who's here. He's provided me with the space and the computer for the show this week. And also to Cliff, the two people that I've met before I got up here. And also everyone else in the Z-Van community for having me come out. I went to the purpose of my trip here was actually to see how to actually start a chapter from scratch and see, come to a place where they've already done it and very successfully. This is pretty much the largest chapter in North America. Is that correct, Matt?
I guess it would be one of the largest and definitely one of the most active as we promote for our promotional events every week.
Yes. And they have a booth right next to the Art Center, and I was able to engage with the public and see what kind of catchy things I could say to get them to stop and listen and pay attention and maybe take a flyer or a DVD. So it's been an incredible learning experience for me, and I'm very happy to be here. What I found was that with the public that we didn't engage with, they did seem to be pretty receptive. If they had enough of an open mind to actually stop and like read the sign and actually consider what we have to say, after the shock of us having answers to their questions and concerns, most everyone who was shocked by that actually gained their interest and they stopped to listen and ask really good questions. So it's definitely not as intimidating as it might seem at first glance to just set up at random. Now, you guys said that you didn't even get a permit, is that right? I mean, you just set up in place?
Yeah, the space we use is essentially open to any group who'd like to set up. There's a lot of artists set up in the area that we do that sell their paintings and whatnot. So we just take a certain portion of the area every week and we speak to hundreds of people. Every time we set up, basically all positively receptive, and we usually give out close to 100 DVDs every time we're out there.
All right, that's good. So it's 100 people a week. I reach 40 to 60 people a week on my radio show, so that's exponentially more. So we definitely need to get started with that. The area that he was in kind of reminds me a lot of Jackson Square, so anyone who's listening in the New Orleans area, Jackson Square is the area where artists go there and set up and sell their paintings right there on the street. But I had always thought that they had gotten some sort of permit. But I guess if I just went maybe like with a civil disobedience and just go there, and if they run me off, they do, and then I'll find out, what do I need to come back?
I just thought this was so cool. Included in the price of a day pass, the Vancouver Public Transit gives you access to a high-speed sea bus. They get you across the bay in just about 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I told you I'm not. Oh, God.
No, that was... couldn't have planned that any better. And that's just about 10 minutes to get across the bay.
Once again, today's episode is called Live from French Quarter. You heard of the Zeitgeist Movement? You have? Okay, great. This is a local radio show that I'm actually currently on right now, and that I do. I'm actually going to be doing it at 10 a.m. some days morning, but it's I'm trying to start a local chapter here for the Zeitgeist Movement. And get people involved and make people aware of the resource-based economy.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Well, so that's two people so far who have actually heard of it already.
Yeah, I heard that.
You heard of the podcast movement? What was that?
It sounds like you got a lot of people out there that have heard of this, like, guys.
Well, at least two so far that have heard of it. Now, I don't know if they mean, you know, a lot of times people say they've heard of the Zeitgeist Movement, but actually they've seen the Zeitgeist movie, but they don't really know about the movement so much. It's one of the problems that we have in the movement is that that first movie really isn't about the movement. It was made before the movement existed, you know, when Peter Joseph was just basically going on a rant. And it wasn't until after that movie that they got in touch with Jacques and Roxanne. So right now I'm at Jackson Square, and I'm looking for people to make eye contact with. You know, in sales or any type of, you know, you're selling an idea, you're selling product or service, you got to, there's a lot of rejection, you know. And but that's okay. Because whenever you want to make a movement and change the world, you run into a lot of resistance and a lot of rejection and a lot of closed minds. But that's fine, because we just want to reach the minds that are open right now, and the rest of them will come along when we hit the critical mass. Boy, it is a beautiful day today. You guys ever heard of the Zeitgeist Movement? Zeitgeist Movement? It's what we call a resource-based economy. No, Zeitgeist, which is it's German for spirit of the times. And we want to change the spirit of the times to where, you know, labor is basically obsolete. Computers and robots do much of the work today anyway. And the average worker does about 40 times the amount of work that they did just 50 years ago. But their wages have not gone up 40 times. So all that productivity has basically been taken by the rich. But we want a more equitable society, a more Star Trek-like existence. This pretty much explains it. But it's based on the resources available, not, you know, machines and things are built to serve a purpose rather than make a profit. And on the other side is a radio show that I'm currently conducting.
All right, I'll see you later.
Huh?
I'll see you later.
You will? Okay, very good. Thank you. So just trying to get the ideas into people's minds, and that's all we're doing right now. Good.
Okay. I go home and I do what I love.
Okay. But what happens when a machine comes along and makes that widget and takes your job and now you're unemployed and you go to try to find another job making a widget somewhere else, but another robot has taken that job as well? What do you do then? What other job?
Robots are going to take care of it.
Yes, they are.
It's not going to happen.
Well, actually, this is the way it's worked. Over 90% of people used to work in agriculture. Now it's less than 1%. 60% of people used to work in manufacturing. Well, no, it's because...
Living in California, where you could buy 100 people right now who are unemployed. You have strawberry fields. That's it. Get rid of these. And you can take their job.
Yeah, you can take their job for $2 an hour and break your back and have all kinds of back problems and no health care. And, Well, I tell you what. Do they pay strawberry pickers $20 an hour?
They don't.
They don't. They pay them minimum wage or less. So. Right. Well, but they make tips and so on. Yeah.
I know there's a lot of stuff that
All right. Well, I mean, if you want to stay in this system forever, I mean, do you think that capitalism is just forever, it'll never end, that that's just how it's going to be from now on until the end of time, or do you see...
It's always been a version of the CD before the rent. It's always been a version of...
What about before money existed?
Trade is money.
Uh-huh.
I mean, if I'm trading, you just keep it up harder, you know, just for that now... Transaction
app,
whether there was actually
something that's called money, it's called a part of the transaction. Okay. Well, you got one. Oh, that's why I already gave you one. So, yeah, so definitely read that over. Visit the websites, listen to the radio show.
And then Zeitgeist 3 Moving Forward came out. So, I went over to Frank Lee So's house to watch it.
So I am live, coming to you from
Frank Lee's house, where we've just finished watching Z3, and I'm here with everyone who has watched the movie, and we're about to discuss it.
Well, I thought it was a vast improvement on the first two, and it brought everything together all into one package.
Yeah, I think it's great as far as like a replacement for everything that came before it. It seemed like it had all the elements, all the good parts of the activist orientation guide as well as the first two movies. So I think it would be the perfect tool to be handing out and creating awareness.
Yeah. And it certainly shouldn't piss on anyone's parade either.
What do you mean by that?
Well, you know, the first movie was made as an art piece, and a lot of people don't appreciate the fact that it was made as an art piece. And it really wasn't intended to be a movement or the materials for a movement. But out of it, a lot of interest grew, and a lot of people were asking Peter, how do you solve all of these problems that you denoted in this movie? And so out of that was born Zeitgeist Addendum, which was the proposed answer to all those things. And now we come full circle with Moving Forward, which actually takes the two movies, consolidates them together into a more holistic understanding of the whole thing. And it also involves a lot of really expert testimony as to what the root causes of all these problems are and understanding the direction in which we're moving.
See, the way I understand the history of that is that Peter Joseph made that first film, you know, railing against all the things that he's railing against, and Jacques and Roxanne actually saw that movie and said, hey, you know, you did a really great job of pointing out the problems. Here's the solution. And that's how they hooked up.
Yeah. And at the same time, Jacques had a couple of admonishments for Peter, you know, I wouldn't have said this, and I wouldn't have done that kind of things, you know. And so Peter did the best he could to kind of correct for that. But as it goes with recorded media, once it's out, it's out. And it's there, and people are going to refer back to it from time to time and form opinions based solely on this older information, not allowing for the fact that people can grow and alter their opinions.
So then Clay contacted me through the Zeitgeist New Orleans Facebook page and wanted to know what he could do to help out. So the two of us went and tabled an art market for the Zeitgeist movement. Unfortunately, our video didn't survive. But afterwards, we went back to my place for some lunch.
Hey everybody, this is Clay from Hammond. As you can see, we're both wearing our Zeitgeist shirts, and we just finished an event at the Zeitgeist Multidisciplinary Arts Center where we met lots of like-minded people. And now he came back with us to have lunch with us from our own homegrown garden here on this nice, pleasant, sunny day. So that's what you get in Zeitgeist. You get free meals. Actually, he worked really hard helping us pack the car and unpacking it. But we had a good time, right, Clay? All right, well, that's Zeitgeist for you.
So then I did Z-Day with this guy.
Never thought Canal Street would be one.
Again.
Yeah. Don't nobody pity New Orleans, cause New Orleans, you'd buy fine without it. Save your pity for a city who needs it. Hurricanes only come for a season. We've been with the wind and rise with the water. If you ain't been there, man, you really oughta to see the sinners and the saints come together, cause we know that we all bleed black and gold.
Whoa.
Just the mic.
I remember when seafood was still on the menu. Used to have an appetite, now we just pretend to. No more crab or crawfish balls, cause nobody wants to eat them, cause it tastes like oil.
I got this. I think we...
So what happened?
Oh yeah.
Nobody wants to eat them cause it tastes like oil. Oil man, if you can, try to help me understand why you couldn't fix the leak, why you didn't have a plan.
Yeah.
It's easy to be greedy, making money so fast, and it's hard to find solutions with your head up your cash. It shouldn't take you so long to clean up the mess. You say you did your best. Come on, BP, that's BS. I said that's BS.
Yeah.
Don't nobody pity New Orleans, cause New Orleans, you're by far went out here. Save your pity for a city who needs it. Hurricanes only come for a season. We've been with the wind, rise with the water. If you ain't been, then man, you really oughta to see the sinners and the saints come together, cause we know how to let the good times roll on. Who'd that say they gon' keep us down? Who that, true that, we that town? Mardi Gras, bring your mom, papa, and your sister. Grab me in your pappy tail and throw me something, mister. Don't nobody pity New Orleans, cause New Orleans, you'd buy fine without it. Save your pity for a city who needs it. Hurricanes only come for a season, cause we've been with the wind, rise with the water. If you ain't been in, man, you really oughta see the sinners and the saints come together, cause we know that we all bleed black and gold.
I have this feedback for you. Y'all want to hear another one, or is that it? You gotta put a quarter in the jukebox. Put the proverbial quarter in the jukebox. Everybody throw that bitch. All right, here we go. So this is the United States of Hysteria. I hope you like this one.
Terror alert is elevated. Your suits can't hide your lies, so bundle them up and syncopate it. What a nice disguise. This is the United States of Hysteria. We got it down to with science is scaring ya. Repetitiousness, viciousness, so that you'll believe. Your better interest is with us trading security. This is the United States of hysteria. We got it down to a science, so scaring ya. Repetitiousness, viciousness, so that you'll believe. Your better interest is with us. So wake up. Turn off your TV. The powers corrupt are infiltrated. No longer can they hide. So create disease, then vaccinate it. Just tell us what's inside. This is the United States of hysteria. We got it down with science, so scaring ya. Repetitious, suspiciousness, so that you believe. Your better interest is with us trading security. Whoa, this is the United States. They see they're cutting me out, those bastards. This is the United States of hysteria. Pledge allegiance, I'll do whatever you say. This epidemic of fear, my freedom's fading away. Fading away. I pledge allegiance, I'll do whatever you say. This epidemic of fear, my freedom's fading away. Your new world disorder is spreading like a disease. If you can make us afraid, then you can make us believe. Yeah. Can make us believe, yeah. This is the United States of hysteria. We got it down to a science, so scaring ya. Repetitious, suspiciousness, so that you believe. The better interest is with us, trade and security. This is the United States of hysteria. We got it down to a science,
Thank you, guys. That's great. Are we being so loud? Are we being loud? Do we have to move? Do we have to go in a tree somewhere?
Shane Paul Smith.
Hey.
Hey.
How's it going?
Big fan.
Thank you.
Hey, the Zeitgeist movement misses you.
Oh, man. Nice. I miss me.
Because we did the event together, the Z-Day.
Yeah, yeah. It's been a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm trying to get my stuff together and, you know, get a band together, and say it's a long process, but I get it, yeah. And I'll be back around.
Okay.
For sure. Hey, you won't miss me long.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you ever want to do that podcast?
I do. Yes, I do, actually. I was supposed to do a UCLA interview and play. UCLA has a radio station, too, so yeah, I need to get into that. Yeah, I do.
Okay.
You've got it on tape now, so now I have to.
Yeah. I got you.
I said I would. Now, so yeah. I'd like to.
So how long have you been here at the Occupy?
3 days.
Are you staying here?
Yeah, I just got a tent today.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that's cool.
So you moved in, so you're the on-site entertainment.
Actually, it's funny you'd say that, because yeah, they made a list of different things, you know, and you know, that they needed people to do, and one of them was entertainment and fun. I said, you can mark me down right there, I'll be that, you know. And so yeah, that was pretty cool. I didn't know I'd be able to do that. You know, I just been kind of playing for little, you know, people here and there, and that's pretty awesome. So. Yeah.
Yeah, well, good to see you.
Yeah, man. It's I'll be back to you, I promise.
Thank you.
I didn't know you were here, man.
Thank you for speaking to me.
Hello! Hi, I'm Larry A. Melesbian, and we're at the Briar Patch Bookstore. This is our first town hall meeting, if you will. It's a meeting of only two people this time, Lauren and I. Lauren's a volunteer here at the Briar Patch Bookstore, and here she is.
Hi.
Hi. And so, This place is being thought of as a possible location for future town hall meetings. One of the things that this location is up against, though, is that it still exists in a monetary system, but it has been able to continue to exist based largely on the efforts of Lauren here, who has donated her time and her effort and her labor to keep this place open. If some of us here in the Zeitgeist movement could volunteer their time to help keep this place open, then it would really go a long way to convincing the owner that we should be allowed to have our meetings here. And it's a great location. I'll show you around in a moment. But these town hall meetings are basically, I know there's only two of us here today, but the idea behind them, first of all, is transparency. Because we're a group that doesn't hide behind secret meetings. You know, there's one of the things is if we ever tried to do anything in secret, if we ever tried to do something that wasn't completely out in the open and public, then obviously the charge would be that we're some sort of, you know, group that's trying to like undermine things and do secretive things, you know, behind closed doors. And if we were secret, people could just make up whatever's in their imagination. And you know how people, the unknown is what scares people the most. So they could make up all kinds of, you know, things about us casting spells or whatever, you know. Whereas if we're right out in the open, there's no chance of that. You know, there's no chance of them saying that we're some sort of cabal, because you can see exactly what we're talking about and exactly what we're saying, and you can see us, and we're real people. So, transparency, gain trust, another T word. Also, the town hall meetings are for trainings and or teach-ins. If you've ever heard of teach-ins, those were things back in the 60s where they were trying to get people aware of certain you know, movements or ideas or motivations, and they would actually teach people things that they may not normally have learned in public school. One of the great things about this bookstore is as I look around on these shelves, I can see a lot of forbidden knowledge. I mean, around the corner here we've got Marx, we've got Anne Rice over here. I just brought in What's the Matter with Kansas by Thomas Frank, but it seems like, you know, all the banned books of history, even Catcher in the Rye is here. But there's a lot of knowledge that is basically been washed out of our public schools. A lot of, say, labor history, for instance, is one of the things. And by having teach-ins, you can actually fill in the blanks for people and make them become aware of things that they wouldn't otherwise be aware if it wasn't for that teach-in. So there's that, and then also, you know, for people to come in and ask questions about the Zeitgeist movement, you know, and they can actually talk to us face-to-face and go on record as having asked this question, and our answer goes on record as well. And also, for another T word, talk. This is a social movement. One of the problems with social movements, one of the reasons why they break up quickly, if you know, if they don't stand the test of time, if they're going to last longer than just a couple of years, it's because the people in those groups know each other and like each other, and it's a social fun event rather than labor, you know, rather than something that's a burden to people, you know, that, wow, you know, changing the world, I mean, that's a lot of weight to lift on just a single set of shoulders, you know. So by showing ourselves in public, people know that we exist and we can see each other, so we know that we're not alone, basically. Whereas if you just sit and just look at all the different problems that face the world, and you may have come up with some solutions or come across some solutions of your own, and you're hanging around the water jug at work, as they call the water cooler wars, and you're talking to your coworkers about these different ideas and solutions that you may have heard of, or even the Zeitgeist movement itself and the different ideas and solutions there, you know, they kind of look at you like you're crazy, you know, like, yeah, like, right, like, man will ever fly, like, that'll ever happen, like, we'll ever make it to the moon, not in my lifetime. And, you know, they just feel kind of isolated and, well, you know, and basically relent over time. Well, maybe you're right, you know.
you guys are the majority, and I'm this one lone person here with a crazy idea. Well, that's really not the case, but the only way you can really feel that is by actually meeting and talking with people. So that's the idea behind the town hall meetings. Now, hopefully this will be an ongoing location here, say every other Sunday at 8 o'clock, second and fourth Sundays. But if not here, we can have them in a different member's home or even in a city park. I suppose I'll have one at my house eventually, which isn't too far from here. It's nice, though, to have it in a public location. Makes people feel more secure and so on. But I'm willing to offer up my own home, and Lauren, you said you...
Mine as well.
You said you can seat how many people?
At least a dozen.
At least a dozen? Okay. So, so basically that's it. I wish I had more for you, but basically that's what we're going to be doing, and we just want you to join us. So please do, so that it's not just Lauren and I next time. Let me show you around just a little bit. This is this place does need some work.
I call it love.
Yeah, love, right. It does need some volunteership just to get some things a little bit organized, and it's a little bit cluttered in here, but it's a work in process, and you can change that. But you can see just wall to wall, ceiling to ceiling, books, aquariums. This would be our meeting space indoors, but look at the fishes. Right out here, out the back door.
I've seen this guy sitting like the mouth that changed the water in there.
Oh, yeah?
And they're off! Woohoo! So they associate that globe with food, you think?
Mm-hmm. And during the day, it gets just a little hotter than the rest of the water. And the toys, they like it cold. So they don't just hang out in there too much during the day. It's in full sun and everything else. But at night, they are all chilling. It's like crowded with all the fish.
Any hypothesis as to why that would be?
I think that a lot of these fish have spent their whole life in a pond and not an aquarium where they've been able to look around. And so being able to look out in the outside world is a brand new concept for them. So it's just taking them some time to get used to it. Like one of these big guys was the first one in there.
Oh, yeah?
And he was in there for about half an hour when we first set it up, just looking around, swimming in, swimming out, looking around, checking it out.
But new territory.
Yeah, I was here at 11 o'clock the other night, and when I came back here to lock up, there's about five or six of the big ones chilling in there, kind of moving around.
Okay. The
seniors are like, enjoy it. It takes a little getting used to.
Alright, cool.
I think the people are kind of scaring them away too. But
So what do you think? Is this a good place for a zeitgeist film night?
We have a Let's go with my stuff.
It's a meeting space.
Definitely in need of a woman's touch. I'm working on that.
Working on getting a woman's touch, or?
Putting it in here. I've been running this shop for almost 2 weeks now. And you should have seen it before. I mean, it is looking so much nicer now.
Thanks to you, huh?
Thanks to me. People are walking in and they're like, oh my goodness. So yeah, I mean, you could like rent the screen or something and drop it here and then put some little chairs out and you sit in the middle of the fish.
Okay.
To watch it, and you don't have to worry if somebody spills a drink or something. Use a hose in here all the time.
Use a hose in here all the time, yeah.
Well, for the fish tank, to fill them up, you know?
All right, yeah, I think this is great.
We get water filled.
Hello, everyone. This is Larry and Melissa. And we're here at Audubon Park conducting our video survey for the Zeitgeist Movement. And have a couple of participants here. Names?
Therese.
I'm Christopher.
Hi, Christopher. The first question in our video blog is, or survey, what is the greatest problem facing humanity today?
I'd say climate problems, environment.
Okay. Are you aware of any science-based solutions to this problem?
Well, I guess there are a lot of, well, part solutions to the problem.
Okay. So it's multifactorial, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But you are aware of the science-based solutions to this problem?
Yes.
Okay. Now, if I told you that on this disc was not only solutions to that problem, but many other problems facing humanity, would you watch it?
Yes.
Okay, great. Here you go. Have you ever heard of the Zeitgeist movement?
No. I think so. Didn't we watch something with the...
They have like the Zeitgeist addendum, and they have three of them now.
I think I've heard of it.
This is called Zeitgeist 3 Moving Forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it pretty much explains what the Zeitgeist movement is about and how we plan to solve the problems facing humanity.
Okay.
Guys?
Zeitgeist movement?
What is it? Is it related to the video?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
There are like three movies out now.
Okay.
So the first question is, what is the greatest problem facing humanity today?
See, I guess I would say like scarcity of resources, like unequal distribution of resources, and
okay.
Education, which and lack of education that comes from not having resources.
Okay, all right, very good. And are you aware of any science-based solutions to this problem?
Science-based solutions. No. I really don't know. Maybe there's some way, like, I think in India, to, like, redirect some of the river water to different areas, and, like, in lower China, but I'm not really sure of...
Okay.
I haven't researched it enough.
Well, I know that, like, studies have been done that show that schools that have, like, breakfast for the kids...
Right.
...and have better nutrition in the cafeteria, they'll get, you know, more fatty acids and so on,
uh-huh.
which will... allow kids to learn better. So malnutrition, I know, is one thing, so that would be resources if you're talking about water to grow food.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, there are many science-based solutions to many of the problems that face humanity on this DVD.
Okay.
So, will you watch it?
Yes, definitely.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for participating in our
survey. It's a well-put-together
movie. Hey, this is Larry at Occupy New Orleans. It's Saturday, November 5th, in front of City Hall, right here in Duncan Plaza. And we're set up here, we're giving away free snowballs. You can see there's already a line. But I'm going to go hand out some flyers and get more people over here. Excuse me. Free snowballs. Here's a flyer. Free snowballs.
See, I'm in Manchester, man. I'm going to be 51. You smoke cigarettes?
Huh?
You smoke?
Smoke?
Cigarettes.
No.
Oh, man. Thank you, man.
You're welcome. Free snowballs.
Snowballs, don't be shy. I got coffee flavor.
At the Merloton Festival.
Free snowballs right over there.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Right
over here.
Thank you.
Hey. Free snowballs.
Right on. Just point me in the right direction.
Across that hill. Free snowballs.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Where?
Right over that hill.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Free snowballs. Right
cool.
Over that hill.
Yeah, here.
Okay, cool. We'll take one of your flyers because you didn't ask us.
It's free.
Live Jesus? Recording, right?
Is it Jesus?
It's not on the internet.
Is it Jesus?
No. It's free snowballs right over there on the other side of the...
Free snowballs on
free
the
snowballs,
side?
Free snowballs, yeah.
Okay, cool. We're going to take this back to our camp right now. So
God bless you, man.
Snowballs.
You can take a picture if you want.
Oh, cool. All right. Yeah, we're part of the Zeitgeist movement. We want everything to be free.
Yeah.
Yeah. Free snow cones. Free snow cones. Okay. Well, can you hand this in? It's
People right there. They'll take that.
I already gave them one. Hey guys.
I have voices in my head saying, kill him.
Free snowballs.
And the guy was asleep. The guy who came over in the red shirt and said he wanted some pants. He wanted me to give him some pants. He was sleeping over here by the pavilion. He was so good, so good, sound asleep. He says he jumped up and started running. He was dreaming that Alan.
We're over by the flagpole.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, free snowballs.
Huh?
On the other side of the pavilion here, over by the flagpole.
Snowballs.
Free snowballs, yeah.
Like the little hostess tree. Snow cones?
Yeah, like the snow cones.
Oh, they've connected them.
That's weird.
Oh, okay.
That's what I got. Oh, that guy's sitting right there.
Yeah, I think he knows where it is.
Okay. Free snowballs. Free snowball, snow cones, free. We're over by the flagpole on the other side of the pavilion.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Free snowballs. We're on the other side of the pavilion by the flagpole. Hey guys.
Hey, how you
doing? Great, thanks for asking. How are you today? Good. Yeah.
That's okay, I'm here. Can I have
one? Yeah.
My hands are a little dirty.
But yeah, we're giving away free snowballs on the other side of the grassy knoll. Over by the flagpole.
What time?
Huh?
What time? Right now?
Right now.
Are they 80 crew?
Oh, yeah, there's no alcohol. All right, so that pretty much covers it. we got a line. You can see, free stuff definitely works. Hey!
Gotta represent my boy. See him right there?
What's that?
That's you right now.
Yeah, it is.
You direct me to Metairie, like, approximately where?
Okay,
we're over here. Right
if
now.
You, okay, let me finish this video. Remember the 5th of November. Here we are. And so is the media. Hey, this is Larry again, and I'm here with...
Michael David Raso.
Michael David Raso, thank you for the full name.
You're welcome.
And we're...
Last name is spelled R-A-S-O.
R-A-S-O, okay, so you're not shy.
No.
Okay, good. And you said that you were a journalist, right?
I was at one point. I did some independent work. I worked for my university, including for NPR, and I was a cameraman, and I did do the interviewing for KNOE and Monroe.
Okay. So how's it feel to be on that side of the camera?
It's...
They got an interview with somebody.
It was rough doing it. It's, I love camera work, I love interviewing people, and I love being interviewed.
Okay.
I love everything about it, except covering more tragic stories was probably the hardest thing to do.
Hmm. Well, speaking of tragic stories, what brings you to the 5th of November bank transfer day?
What brings me to the 5th of November bank transfer day is a desire to move my money out of a large corporate enterprise and into a local credit union.
Nice guy.
The reason for that is that I feel that banks such as Chase and Capital One have become too big to fail. And once they're too big to fail, they're too big to be around. They need to shrink down and become, if they want to stick around at all, to be a safe investment like they used to be. That is what a bank is supposed to be, a place to secure your money, not a place to gamble with it, not a place to make CEOs and board members rich.
You're camping at the site, right?
But that's what it's become now. It's become about greed, and that has to stop.
Yeah, have you heard, the best quote I like about that is Bernie Sanders. He says, too big to fail is too big to exist.
I am a huge fan of Bernie Sanders.
Bernie Sanders,
and I deeply agree with him. I believe that they are too big to exist at this point. We need to invest in institutions that give back to the community, not back to themselves.
And I guess you're familiar with the Glass-Steagall then, right?
I am not, actually.
Oh, okay. Well, the Glass-Steagall Act came out after the 1930s Depression, and the idea was to separate investment banks from mortgage banks.
Actually, I have heard of that.
Yeah.
I didn't know the title of it.
Yeah.
And it seems things like that have gone out. That, along with the Fairness Act, everything that was for the people has become for business.
Right.
And
well, you know, corporations are people too.
Corporations have people in them.
Yeah.
But that is dispersed responsibility. Nobody gets charged with anything. Nobody has to take responsibility because it's so dispersed. And when I forget who said this, but when I see a corporation executed, then I'll consider it a person.
Yeah.
But at this point, they get the rights of an average single person and all the freedoms of a business. It's not fair.
Mm-hmm.
And it's time for it to stop.
Well, thank you, Michael.
Welcome, Larry.
Crowd's growing a bit.
We're chilling.
Yeah. So I have forms if you want to shut for Chase Bank. I have them online, Capital One, to count those forms. Help expedite the process. So does anyone want an account closing form from Chase?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Anyone else at Chase that wants to?
Will this identify us in any kind of way? Or, I mean, like, will they say, oh, people will bring these in today or part of the November 5th?
I haven't put it in my car. I forgot to bring it. So, I mean,
it's 2576.
I want to shut my account down.
I'm not quite sure. I mean, I'm not quite sure what that says.
Well, cool. I know you're from New York.
All right. Does anybody have a chant? You want a chant?
So how do folks think that we should like start moving soon, or do we think that maybe we should wait and see if more people come in the next
what time is it now?
I've got 9:30.
I think it's time to go then.
What's that?
We got sold out.
Everything you said.
We got sold out.
I just hope we can
We got sold out. We got sold out. We got sold out. We got sold out.
Banks got bailed out.
We got sold out.
Banks got bailed out.
We got sold out.
Banks got bailed out.
We got sold out.
We got sold out.
Banks got bailed out.
We got sold out. We got sold out.
Banks got bailed out.
We got sold out.
Here we are at Chase Bank, and I'm going in. Wish me luck.
Does anyone want this stuff to pass out to people?
Oh.
It's just our press release.
Okay, I'll do it. Chad.
All right.
I
was
so far in the Chase group, but we're waiting for two more.
Okay. You're the other guy.
Getting ready to close my account.
Right,
you guys ready to go in?
I'm ready.
Yes.
Alright. You want us to chant while you're going in? Or just...
Hi, this is Larry and...
David.
David here at the Occupy New Orleans. And we were just talking about, you know, I'm obviously with the Zeitgeist Movement. And we were talking about how we found the movement. We both found it through Future by Design.
Indeed.
You were saying...
Yeah, no, I guess I just happened to come across Future by Design on Netflix, and it seemed really interesting to me, so I watched the film, and I was really impressed with Mr. Fresco's work and his ideas. I have to admit, I kind of, I had some doubts about how realistic the ideas are, and how easy it would be to implement them. I think it's like some great ideas. And I have heard since I first saw that film that there's various ideas about transitional stages between now and kind of the full implementation of those ideas.
Yeah.
And I'm curious to hear more about that because even no matter how rational the ideas are, you have to deal with the situation of what is going on in the world, and you know, this is not a world full of rational people that are ready to embrace an idea just because it's a good idea.
Oh yeah, I understand that, and it's, you know, it's always the status quo that is, you know, holds us back. It's, people have a really hard time seeing beyond what they already know. They have a hard time seeing outside of their reality, basically.
That's true.
And so that's why it's hard, you know, social change is hard to come by. But yeah, I mean, it's all scientifically, it's all been worked out. I mean, it all, you know, makes sense. As far as a transition, my own personal favorite is 30-hour work week, as automation takes away jobs. You have to reduce the work week to share the workload, just like they did in France, and then 20 hours, 10 hours, and eventually zero. And by the time we get there, that would be a peaceful transition into the Zeitgeist world, Venus Project world. But that's just one path, and most likely it'll be a revolution and upheaval and reconstruction, like the Civil War kind of thing. But that's probably the path it'll take. It doesn't have to take that path, but that's probably the way it'll go. And this is, you know, Occupy New Orleans, Occupy Movement is part of that transition.
Yeah. We're still in an early stage of it. We've been here about a week, and I would say that there's already significant signs of distress within the movement, but hopefully, if it's a true movement that has potential, we're going to work through any kind of bumps in the road and solve our problems within the movement and the divisions and move forward in a positive direction. Speaking of moving forward in a positive direction,
yeah,
it looks like there may be
what great timing.
Hopefully, hundreds of people moving forward in a positive direction,
yeah,
coming
as we
back
speak
to the square. This is the first major march ever since we started the occupation. It's October 15th, the Global Day of Solidarity. There are people doing this very thing in hundreds of cities around the world, so it's a really exciting moment. I unfortunately was working, so I wasn't able to take part, but I came here to meet them as they come back and see what kind of energy they're bringing. Reports from people who are marching are that it was a good turnout, something similar to the original march that we had on October 6th, so that means hundreds of people. We had about 400, was a rough estimate on the 6th. From the sound of it, there's some energy out there.
Yeah.
I'm really hoping that this march is going to bring some fresh energy into the movement, because we could definitely use it. This is kind of a make it or break it moment, in my opinion, because there's been some splintering, as is inevitable in a grassroots movement with no, strict hierarchy. You're going to have different people with different ideas, and we're just all starting to learn about the consensus building process. And faltering, but hopefully, if we push through this hump.
So have you been here occupying since October 6th?
I have. I've slept a couple nights at home, but mostly I've been sleeping out here in the park. I've been working hard in the kitchen with a number of other people to make sure people get fed. I've been here since day one. I was at the initial planning meeting that you were at on Sunday before the occupation began. And it's been a roller coaster, let's put it that way. A lot of hopeful moments, a lot of exciting moments, and some disappointing ones where we've seen that consensus and true unity are not to be taken for granted.
Yeah.
There's a... anywhere where everybody has a right to say and do as they please, you're not going to have 100% unity, but hopefully we can learn to work together and keep moving forward, because I believe...
Speaking of moving forward, that's the title of our latest movie.
Is it?
If you go,
I'll be looking out for it.
Zeitgeistmovingforward.com and just hit play, and it pretty much explains what the whole movement's about. It's 2.5 hours.
Do you know when that was released?
It was released in January.
Okay.
Yeah.
I believe I have seen it. That's the first Zeitgeist movie that I saw, actually.
Okay.
It was impressive. A lot of interesting ideas in there that should be discussed, especially among people such as these.
And you would think this would be a pretty receptive audience, then.
I would, definitely. I mean, these are people that want to change the world, that are tired of the status quo, that are looking for answers, that are, disappointed with the way that our society is working. So,
all right,
this is fertile ground for those ideas.
Yeah. Yeah, I would think so. And it seems like everyone I've ran into have been really positive about it, and a lot of times we'll run into people who say, oh, that'll never happen because of human nature and this and that. But here I found that people are like, well, what we're doing now isn't working, so...
Might as well put our heads together and try to come up with a better solution.
I agree. So this is the people from the march group standing there. This place is filling up pretty quick now. All right, well, thanks a lot, David.
Yeah, it was a pleasure.
And look for us at Zeitgeist New Orleans Facebook page. And my website for a link through to that is malelesbian.org.
All right.
What happened?
I'm leaving. Hello.
Can I get you on camera?
I prefer not, actually.
Oh, okay.
But thanks for asking. And because I don't want to put it in the chicken. But anyways, fuck this guy's only.
Houston, we have a problem. How y'all doing out there?
Here they go. Bye.
How y'all doing out there?
If you or anybody feels that they've
come to these guys, I really need y'all to gather out for a minute. Just gather out. We need you to gather together. We need you to gather together and help us in this movement. We need your numbers. We need you to be involved in the online community and follow what's going on. And
We need help out here too. We need numbers. All of you. We really appreciate you coming out. And how about that? We got to go through the Outer Belt projects, and we all break the law together. Amen. Amen. Doesn't it feel good when you get brought down? Down by the man. That's Jason. It's JJ over here. Hey, y'all. JJ over here. Hey, I want y'all to just come over here and join the air. Get together with each other and just talk, you know? And get together, man. I really want to see a movement out here. I wanted to see everybody for the Out of the Belt projects over here. We have the homeless people over here, all the people that really hurt from the corporations, that hurt the world. This is really important.
Time that went past somehow. Yay, there it is, 2012.
Here we go into Auld Lang Syne here in Times Square, and you can see the confetti fly. There's about a ton of confetti.
Now we still got an hour.
In the next few minutes here, more than 2,000 pounds.
Oh yeah, that's right. So we still got an hour, see? So that's pretty arbitrary then, huh?
Yep.
So do we get a ball to drop in our time zone?
Yeah. Downtown.
Downtown, New Orleans.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
The fireworks and everything, yes.
Well, I kind of felt like nothing had changed, you know, when the ball dropped. So I guess now I know why. Because it's not really 2012 yet. Hey, look at those people. They're in the future. Look. Those people are in the future. They're in a whole nother year. We gotta wait till next year to see him. Concludes 2011 and the first episode of NOLAz TV. I hope you've enjoyed the show. Join us next time when we speak with Mark from Earthship Biotecture and travel through Texas. You won't want to miss it. It's an action-packed episode. So, we'll see you then.